Major funding for the Colores series was provided by the McCune Foundation.
Somebody says put it into a diet. You don't put bombers into a diet. Said, well, let it be a first time. And it rattled and cracked, and it felt like it was going to fall apart.
Mayhem was our business. Next.
Second World War, given all the sorrow that came with it, was the greatest thing that happened to the Hispanic population of New Mexico.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover.
We saw vistas and horizons that we didn't even know existed. The new panorama provided an expansion of the spirit. Now we wanted something more. I hold a reverent and deep love for the mountains and the life I knew in Tierra Amarilla. The mountains made me an Hispano first and an American next. They were worth fighting for. Many did and died. Some of us did and don't forget.
And Jimmy will go to sleep in his own little room again.
Tierra Amarilla is today a ghost town. It was a thriving, prosperous community when I was there. I was in Tierra Amarilla when it was announced over the radio that the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor. The following morning, before the sun came out, there were lines of young men that were lined up at the draft board. They came out of the villages. They came out of the mountains. They came out of the ranches to enlist. That for my people in northern New Mexico, patriotism was a very real and fiery reality. My people had found in northern New Mexico the freedom, the liberty that the Hispanic peoples have been searching all over the world. Always. And we found it there. And for us, we were not fighting for the great cities like New York, Chicago, San Francisco. None of us had ever been there. No, we were fighting for the cattle, the sheep, and the horses that were our livelihood.
Well, tell me one thing. Why did you choose Air Force?
Well, two reasons. One of them is that I was afraid of heights. I still am. I went to the Empire State Building, went up to the top and looked over the side, and almost passed out. I considered that to be a defect. A deficiency in my makeup, in my character, and that I had to overcome that. And the other reason was that I was not going to walk through the war. I wasn't going to freeze my butt or sleep in the mud the way the infantry people have to do. Those are the two reasons.
So what did you wind up doing in the Air Force?
I ended up being the ball turret gunner in a B-17. It was a plane that won the war. It took more guts and more courage to get down into that ball turret than it did to face the Germans in war later on.
It was a time of dying. It was a time of sorrow and tears. The angel of death was flying insanely over the earth, coming down haphazardly to kiss the forehead of an innocent young man in uniform.
When we arrived in Wellingborough and we walked into the barracks, it was the barracks of the squadron that had been shot down by the Germans. The clothes were still hanging on the racks. The pictures of their parents, their wives, their children, their girlfriends were still up. When the lights went out and we went to bed, in the very same beds that those young people had occupied, it was eerie, and it was a long time before we went to sleep. Well, that first night, four or five of my crew were chosen, but I wasn't. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, they came to wake them up. And this morning was a foggy morning, the way only England knows foggy mornings to be. They couldn't see the runway from the control tower. And these bombers would take off at 30-second intervals. Well, the first one took off, and I don't know whether it was the first one. One of them took off and had a blowout. And it careened, and it was crossways on the runway. Well, the one behind it crashed into it, and the third one crashed into those two. And there was an explosion that rocked the area. I was still in bed. And I sat up in bed, and a big chunk of iron came in through the Neeson hut. The barracks weren't regular barracks. They were like barrels, metal barrels cut in half, and they called them Neeson huts. It came in on one end and out the other, leaving a gaping hole like that, or bigger than that. And I thought we were being bombed by the Germans. But I was so stupefied that I just sat there. Finally, I had collected my faculties around me, and I went out and found out that these three planes had crashed, and the military police had already fenced off the area. And there was a crater there, 75 feet wide, and I don't know how many feet deep. But I did see a human foot in a GI shoe. I was so affected that I sat down and threw up. And I cried. There were 10 crewmen in each one of those planes. 30 Americans went poof. Next morning, it was my turn. And it was foggy, like the day before. And we took off like that, at 30-second intervals. And that puts a knot in your intestines.
What a lonely, loneliness. Outside the plane. Out of the earth. Outside of time. Shot through space like an errant comet by forces beyond my control.
And down there in the vault earth, you're outside of the world. You're even outside the plane. That feeling can be very overwhelming. The feeling that you want to just call on the intercom just to establish contact. The fighter planes would accompany us about one third of the way. And we would sit there and watch the dogfights. And we'd see the planes go down. And we'd cheer when it was one of theirs, just like making a touchdown. And of course, we'd lament when it was one of ours. Then they hit us with flak. And you could see the puff of smoke when they exploded. But you couldn't hear the explosion. But what you did hear was the shrapnel hitting your plane. And you'd hear it hitting the tin skin of the plane and coming right through, like hail on a tin roof. Well, this time we were coming into the bomb run in Berlin when we were hit. And this went right through the wing and broke the main spar of the wing and went through and left a big hole on the plane. And what was holding that wing together was a skin. We also had a dead gunner in the waste compartment. We used to use steel aprons to protect us from flak. And steel helmets. But this chunk of flak came in through the bottom and hit him here. Avoided the apron and the helmet. And the pilot was hit. A 20 millimeter gun came right through his steel helmet on one side and out the other. Scrambled his brains. And the co-pilot was flying the plane. So, first thing to do was get rid of those mugs. And says, where? Somebody said, let's find a swanky neighborhood. So that's what we did. But by this time, one of the engines had been hit, and it was on fire. Co-pilot called us on the interphone. These are the choices. We bail out, or we ride it down in a dive, hoping that the wind will blow the fire out. Somebody said, put it into a dive. He said, but you don't put bombers into a dive. I said, well, let it be a first time. And it rattled and cracked, and it felt like it was going to fall apart, especially when he pulled it out. A shock. Slowly, ever so slowly, he pulled up a little. But by that time, the second motor was hit. So we started off from Berlin, going back home to the British Isles, 600 miles away or so, with two motors gone on one side. And we couldn't reach altitude anymore. And we were flying at treetop level. And we came upon a platoon of German soldiers marching down an avenue of trees. When we came up upon him suddenly, and we trained our machine guns on him. And I was laughing insanely because I had the silly notion that they were puppets
and that they would fold when I cut their strings. I enjoyed that fantasy. I was laughing, silly. Didn't occur to me that they were people. We went on. We'd fly over towns, then we'd rake our machine guns over the rooftops. On the Rhine, there are all those houseboats, they're full of them. We'd rake our machine guns on them. And we'd listen to the radio where the Germans were saying that we were a wild elephant running loose in Europe. And then we ran out of ammunition because we didn't think we'd get as far as we did because our plane was just huffing and puffing. Then the tail gunner says, bandits at 6 o'clock. We all knew we were dead, but we couldn't even fight back. And then over the intercom, I heard the sweetest words in the English language. Little friend to big friend, don't worry, we'll take you home. They were American fighter planes. And one of them parked itself on each wingtip and one in front. We were just flying, just barely over the water on the English Channel. And we just clambered, it seemed, crawled over the white cliffs of Dover. We landed on our belly, because our landing gear had been shot. When I got off the plane, the first thing I did was got down on my knees and kissed the ground. When all of a sudden, an Englishman appeared with a bottle of whiskey and filled a tumbler full of whiskey. And he said, drink it. Drink it all. And I drank a full tumbler of whiskey. And that Englishman saved my life. Or at least he saved my sanity, because I was about to fly off. This is my old Air Force jacket. The name of our plane was El Lobo. It fits after all these years. And we had a Lobo painted on the back of our leather jackets, and also the number of missions that we had flown. Over and over again, we were hit so badly that our plane couldn't keep up with a flight on the way back to England. And we trailed behind. Our friends in the squadron started calling us a lone wolf. And from lone wolf to El Lobo was a very short step. We would get 3-day passage to London. We could have gone anywhere else in England and been safer. But London was the legendary capital of England. That's where the action was. So that's where we went. And the bombs were falling like leaves. At night, there was a blackout. It was black. Black could be. So as you walked the streets, all you could hear was so sorry, so sorry, so sorry. People were bumping into each other. We used to stay at a hotel called the Strand Palace. There were dances, Covent Gardens and other places. But I didn't go, so I'd stay in the cocktail lounge of the hotel. This particular night, I was writing a poem, a love poem to my wife, when a bomb hit across the street. And I ended up under a table. When the lights went on, I discovered that other person under the table was
a young English woman in evening clothes. But her evening clothes were wrapped around her neck. And I could see everything. And I could see nothing. Because they wore the bloomers. Bloomers that came down all the way down to their knees. She stood up, and I still was laying down on the floor. And she looked down on me and she said something like, "Smashing, isn't it?" I don't know. But it was ludicrous. I felt like laughing, only I didn't. And I straightened up. And she invited me to meet with her friends. They were out for a night. After that, she took me to all the nooks and crannies and showed me that legendary city from within. And we became very close friends. When I finished my combat tour, I came home. And I became an instructor in a gunnery school for combat crews that were going overseas. So everyone in the family and friends were inviting me out to dinners, parties, and I was having a ball. But a certain uneasiness started creeping up. I'd be invited out to dinner and my hands would start shaking so badly I couldn't hold my food. Or somebody would slam a door behind me and I'd go out through the window. I'd wake up at night screaming, bathed in sweat. And there was a recurring nightmare. It's the same one, always. It was a tornado that appeared way out in the distance. But it kept spiraling in, getting closer and closer and closer. As it got closer, I had the feeling that it was a tornado of blood, and it was about to absorb me. And that's when I wake up screaming. When I went back to the Air Force, they checked me, and they found that I had severe combat fatigue. I abhor the very thought of war.
How many letters?
Four.
Talk about the rites of passage.
Four letters.
I think I grew up.
That's a plural.
I think I became a man, and I think my character was formed and set in the war-torn skies over Europe. I think a respect for the decency of life and the value of life was established. I don't think about the war very often. I don't have to. The war is part of my being, part of my makeup. Everything I see, everything I say, everything I think is somehow filtered, somehow conditioned by a war that happened a long time ago. A war is not something you hang in the closet and forget about it. A war is something you wear, you carry with you, and is with you at all times.
Fuhrer says the is der master race. We right in the Fuhrer's face. Not to love the Fuhrer is a great disgrace. So we right in the Fuhrer's face. When her Goebbels says we own the world and space, we right in her Goebbels' face. When her Goering says they'll never bomb this place, we right in her Goering's face. Are we not the supermen? Are you pure supermen? Ja, wie is der supermen? Super duper supermen. Is this Nazi land so good? Would you leave it if you could? Ja, this Nazi land is good, and we would leave.